Catholic Health Services hospitals deliver exceptional maternity services. As such, they are continually offering the newest services and advances. We'll hear from two CHS hospitals today, St. Catherine of Siena Medical Center and Mercy Medical Center, about the latest in maternity services. That's on today's episode of CHS Presents, Lifestyles at the Heart of Health. Joining me is Kristen Thayer, lactation perinatal education clinical nurse specialist from Catholic Health Services St. Catherine of Siena Medical Center. Welcome. Thank you so much for joining us. And we should first mention that St. Catherine of Siena Medical Center was named a baby-friendly hospital. It's the first hospital in Suffolk County to earn this prestigious international recognition. So you guys must be thrilled to have gotten this designation.
Oh, we are thrilled. It was a long journey, and it shows that we offer the optimal level of care for our maternity patients.
So what is a baby-friendly hospital? Because to me, any hospital I go to, the baby part is the best part.
Well, I agree. It is the best part. And a baby-friendly hospital that's designated has proven to follow the 10 steps of successful breastfeeding. And this ensures that mothers leave the hospital more successful with breastfeeding.
But it's also about the bonding experience, is it not?
Oh, absolutely. We encourage non-separation of mothers and babies from birth to going home. We want the mothers to do skin-to-skin contact as soon as possible after the delivery, and even the fathers enjoy skin-to-skin contact. That's the best place for the newborn to be.
So does that mean you don't really have like a general nursery as such, or and the babies sleep in the same room with the mothers and all of that? How does that work?
We encourage rooming in, which is where the mothers stay in the same room with their baby. This facilitates breastfeeding. We do have a nursery, and the mothers can request for the babies to be watched in the nursery whenever they choose, but we find most mothers prefer to have the baby with them.
So do you see a big difference for this baby-friendly designation with first mothers or mothers who are having a second or a third or even more children?
Well, it's very gratifying to see a mother having her second or third child and saying, wow, how different things are.
Uh-huh.
And starting with the skin-to-skin contact in the delivery room, what distinguishes a baby-friendly hospital is that we do skin-to-skin contact and non-separation from the delivery. We don't interfere with the mother and baby bonding, with the normal hospital routines and procedures that need to be done, but we put the patient and the baby first so that they can bond and have that special time together. We actually call it the golden hour.
The golden hour, you mean right after birth?
Yes.
Oh, I love that. That is so sweet. I mean, that's one of the most miraculous moments ever, is when you've just had a baby and you're seeing this live human being right there for the first moment.
Yes, we dry the baby and then gently transition the baby right onto the mother's chest. And there the baby is kept warm. And research shows that the babies are warmer on their mother's chest than they would be in the hospital warmer. So they're gently eased the transition into life outside their mothers.
So you mentioned the breastfeeding part, which can be really difficult for some women because, you know, it's a process. It's a process of learning. It's an experience. So talk to me about that part of the designation.
Well, what baby-friendly designation means is we follow the 10 steps of successful breastfeeding. And these steps are research-proven steps that if you follow these steps, you're more likely to be successful with breastfeeding. And we found that some of the steps involve changing our hospital procedures. From not separating the mother and the baby, we do all of our procedures that need to be done with the baby, from the bath and the medications, even the blood draws, all are done at the bedside. The physicians will examine, the pediatricians will come to the mother's bedside and examine the baby in front of them, and this is a real learning experience. It also includes family members in the caring of the baby. It's very nice for siblings to come visit, and the baby's in the room, and they get to bond with their family.
But the breastfeeding part of it, so those 10 steps include what other kinds of, how does that work?
So to help with breastfeeding, first we start with skin-to-skin contact. Then we room in, we keep the baby at the bedside. Studies show that a newborn baby needs to breastfeed frequently. This is the key. And if the babies are separated, they're not feeding as frequently. We also want the babies to not be stressed. And babies want to be with their mothers. They are calm and they cry less if they're with their mothers. And being held skin to skin is so important. We also do not recommend a pacifier in the first few days of breastfeeding. We do not supplement with formula unless there's a medical reason. And it's always the parent's choice, but when we assure that they've gotten the proper education and information, it's easy to follow the 10 steps.
So when you're thinking about this then, I mean, most women, two of my nieces had babies in August, and in both cases, they went home within a day of giving birth, which I think is pretty common. So I understand what you're saying about this whole, you know, this process, but when you go home so quickly, what if it's not exactly working perfectly, the breastfeeding part?
Well, every mother, when she leaves the hospital, does timely follow-up with her pediatrician, usually within a day or two, which will support her breastfeeding. And we also offer at the hospital a weekly free lactation support group. Mothers come with their babies, and any questions or concerns they have, we have a couple of hours where they can, in a comfortable environment, receive the help that they need. They can also always call or email and get support over the phone.
So even mothers who didn't give birth at the hospital can come to this?
Yes, this is a community support group, and we offer it to anybody in the community that needs the services. We also offer free prenatal breastfeeding classes before people deliver, and getting the information before you come to the hospital has been really helpful with their success. And if they follow those 10 steps and leave the hospital exclusively breastfeeding, all the research shows they're much more likely to continue breastfeeding long-term and reap the health benefits with breastfeeding.
And what do, you said that mothers who've come that are having their second or third child there are really astonished by the differences. But what about the first-time mothers? Do you find that they are, you know, what do they say to you? Do they understand that, because I know it was hard for me, the breastfeeding part, so I'm just wondering what kind of reaction you get from them with this designation now.
Well, the first-time moms, they love that the babies can room in with them, and they love that they can have a family member or their husband, somebody stay with them the whole time they're there, because it's the emotional bonding with the baby. It's the whole family benefits with this, and they benefit in a baby-friendly hospital. We also strive to give consistent positive messages about breastfeeding. The staff are all trained breastfeeding counselors. They all give the same information, and it helps them be successful.
How long does somebody typically breastfeed these days?
Well, the recommendation from the American Academy of Pediatrics is to exclusively breastfeed for 6 months.
6 months.
To get the most benefit of the breast milk. But any amount of colostrum or breast milk the baby gets is good for the baby, and it's also good for the mother.
Do you give them advice about, like, nutrition and what they should or should not be eating in terms of the breast milk before the...
Oh, absolutely. We have all breastfeeding mothers get a dietary consult, and we recommend just a healthy diet. Breastfeeding newborns actually have less food allergies later in life because they're exposed to all the different foods that the mother has been eating. So we just recommend a good, healthy diet and lots of water.
And bottom line is, women have been having babies and feeding them through breastfeeding forever. So it's great to be able to encourage that and make sure that it continues.
Yes, and It's wonderful because you're offering the best nutrition for your baby. There's the antibodies, which help prevent infections, but it's also all about the bonding and the special relationship that the mother and the baby have.
Aww. Makes me want to have a baby now. Thank you so much. We're going to take a quick break, but our discussion continues with more information about CHS maternity services right after this. Welcome back to CHS Presents Lifestyles at the Heart of Health. Joining us now is Dr. Demetrios Mastrogiannis, who is the Chairman of Maternal Fetal Medicine for Catholic Health Services and is the Chief of Maternal Fetal Medicine at Mercy Medical Center. So thank you so much for being with us. That's a mouthful of what you do, but bottom line is you are in charge of maternity services and helping women have healthy babies.
Thank you for having me, Jane. That's true.
Yes. Now, I'm just curious. You've delivered, what, around 4,000 babies in your lifetime in your practice?
Yes.
And you're now making sure using all kinds of advanced services to give them the best services possible. What do you think are the most significant changes in what you do now?
We have come a long way. Now we have preventive services for a lot of problems that we didn't know what we were doing 30 years ago, such as preterm labor prevention, women with significant risk for complications. Now we can supervise them and optimize their outcome. And the bottom line is we improve their care and their babies do much better nowadays.
And deliver healthy babies.
Yes.
Which didn't always used to be the case. So talk to me, if you can, about some of those advances and who should come to see you guys specifically.
Okay. Let's start from the second part of your question. Women can be considered high risk because they have already a problem and they have concurrent pregnancy, or they can become high risk during their pregnancy or labor. Just to give you some of the statistics, ballpark, about 20% of women pregnant women have high risk factors before the delivery, and 20% develop them during labor. So a significant number of women require expertise and help to have an optimal outcome and a good baby.
You just said 40%. If you put
yes.
those two together, that's a lot.
That's a lot.
So before pregnancy, what are considered high risk?
Before pregnancy, we have people with specific medical disorders such as high blood pressure, diabetes, even obesity is considered, morbid obesity is considered a risk factor for a potential problem development later on. Patients with all kinds of medical condition. Something that has been evolving over the past 10 years is obese patients who had bariatric surgery. You had prior programs for that.
Oh, yeah, sure.
More and more patients who consider their fertility kind of gone because of the obesity. They get obesity reduction services with surgeries and programs. Their fertility comes back. Some of their conditions
wow.
reverse, such as diabetes. Diabetes improves with the bariatric surgery, and then they become pregnant.
Right.
Sometimes as a surprise, many times planned. And these women now who can help.
Right.
And
I'm sure that's so wonderful for them because they thought this would never happen, and now it is. I mean, what a blessing. But they need your help.
Spontaneous, absolutely.
Yeah. What about, there's an awful lot of women, too, who are now seeking fertility specialists for a number of other reasons. Maybe it's because it's age-related or whatever. And they are considered high risk?
Yes, they do. They are considered high risk. The reason is that the demographics of pregnant women is changing. Mm-hmm. They become a little older. They postpone their reproductive choices that they have.
So they come to you, and you have the ability to, use all kinds of different and new, really advanced tests to determine the health of the fetus and the mother and optimize that. So can you talk to me a little bit about some of these tests that might be new and different?
Yes. First of all, we start with the preconceptual counseling if we are lucky enough to get the woman before she becomes pregnant. Mm-hmm. That's very important because that's the one and only opportunity that we have to address some of the conditions before the pregnancy. For example, if a woman has high blood pressure or diabetes for that matter, it's a good idea to optimize their glucose control before they become pregnant.
Sure.
Because unfortunately, glucose is considered a teratogen. Mm-hmm. Very high glucose, of course, we're talking about. So that's the prime time to intervene and prevent some of the problems. When the pregnancy enters, the woman enters the pregnancy, then we start following them from the very beginning. The most important part is to establish an accurate due date, because that way we almost eliminate postdatism and problems with that. Mm-hmm. After we establish an accurate due date, we start developing screening programs. We screen the baby at almost every trimester, every beginning, middle, and late pregnancy, the baby, for problems. We do prenatal diagnosis, as it's called, and we follow the pregnancy for development of complications. Now, we have many techniques to do that. The screening techniques that we have are ultrasound, sophisticated ultrasound. Mm-hmm. We're looking in the first trimester of pregnancy. We're looking at the baby's neck, the fat pad at the natus, at the baby's neck, and the thickness of this fat pad gives us an idea what's the risk for genetic abnormalities, for chromosomal anomalies such as Down syndrome.
That's pretty amazing.
Yes, it is. Along with that, we have blood tests. Now, we do extensive screening for certain women who are at high risk. They are over the age of 35. They have other markers to screen and diagnose conditions much earlier using the technique of self-refill DNA. This technique is a blood test.
So it's self, what did you call it?
Self-free-fill DNA.
Self-free DNA, okay.
Yes. What happens is the placenta, which is the organ that feeds the baby and attaches to the mother's womb, the uterus, this placenta that feeds the baby, that is genetically baby stuff,
right,
loses some of its DNA to the maternal blood. It becomes free.
Right, so that's just another way of telling.
Right.
And then from all of this, you can determine if there's some drugs that are necessary, some medications, maybe bed rest, maybe all kinds of things to give both mother and baby the chance to have the best optimal outcome.
That's correct. Then we can, as a matter of fact, eliminate unnecessary procedures. In order to diagnose somebody, let's say, with Down syndrome, and we used to do many amniocentesis to find, let's say, one. In my earlier days, about 20 years ago, I used to do 60 to 70 amniocentesis in my practice to discover one case of Down syndrome.
Wow, that's amazing.
Now, things have changed, and we do one or two procedures to diagnose a baby that has it, either amniocentesis or CVS.
It is just so amazing where we have come and what you have accomplished. And I mean, I'm in awe of what you're doing. We have to take a break, but you're not going anywhere because we're going to keep talking in just a moment. We'll return with more of CHS Presents in just a moment. Welcome back to CHS Presents, Lifestyles at the Heart of Health. And we are discussing maternity services. Back with us again is Kristen Thayer, lactation, perinatal education, clinical nurse specialist at CHS's St. Catherine of Siena Medical Center, and Dr. Demetrios Mastriogiannis, who is the chairman for maternal fetal medicine at Catholic Health Services and the chief of maternal fetal medicine at Mercy Medical Center. Welcome back again. Can we talk a little specifically about Mercy Hospital and what a woman can get when she comes there seeking special help for her maternity?
Yes. We started in July 2017. I was hired to develop the services for the Catholic healthcare system broadly and specifically for Mercy. And Mercy is a tertiary care center. Very few centers are tertiary care centers. That means that they provide 24/7 obstetrical care by a generalist, board-certified obstetrician-gynecologist, anesthesia on-site 24/7 for laboring mothers, maternal medicine coverage 24/7 by board-certified obstetrician as I am, and perinatologist as I am, 24/7 specialty consultations by cardiologists, hematologists, whatever they need. NICU coverage. NICU coverage is very important. A tertiary care coverage means that a baby can deliver at Mercy at any gestational age and after 23 or 24 weeks and have the chance to survive with the care that's provided at Mercy. That's not for every hospital. They'll have to make this distinction.
So if somebody's having a really difficult time and a difficult pregnancy and they may not even be a patient of a doctor who practices at Mercy, can they still come there and get the help that they need? Because it sounds like you guys are premier, state-of-the-art.
Yes, of course they can. Usually the services that we provide in maternal medicine have their women originate in somebody's in a general provider of maternal medicine, of general obstetrics and gynecology, who is referred to us because of requiring specialized services, sophisticated ultrasound, prior complication, developing complications, or the woman can see direct care to us if she has, for example, history of preterm birth. And please, to the audience, if you have your baby delivered before 37 weeks in prior pregnancy, please seek medical attention.
Yeah.
Because we can give you preventive cases and decrease your risk for recurrence by at least 40 to 50%.
Wow, that's an amazing statistic. You also, for preemie babies, you have a breast milk bank, right?
That is correct.
Well, that's amazing, which leads me right to you, because, of course, breastfeeding is a very important part of what you do at St. Catherine of Siena, because you are a baby-friendly designated hospital. How important is that for you?
Oh, the breast milk is important for every baby, but especially for the premature babies or the NICU babies. And what we do at our hospital at St. Catherine's, any mother that delivers a baby that must be in our neonatal intensive care unit, we support them to, as soon as possible, do skin-to-skin with their baby and to breastfeed. And we also offer breast pumps or help them express their breast milk so we can get that breast milk to them as soon as possible.
You must be so proud of this baby-friendly designation. And I know that there aren't that many hospitals that have it. You're the only one in Suffolk County. How important is that for you, for the people who work at the hospital, and for the mothers who deliver there?
Well, it's wonderful to work at a hospital that shows how much they care about the mothers and babies. And people that deliver at the hospital know they're going to get the best in maternity care, and they'll get all the help they need with breastfeeding to get off to a good start and support after they delivered.
And so bottom line is this is the designation that you guys worked hard for and are very proud of.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And I'm sure that you're proud as well, but I'm just thinking to myself as I'm listening you describe this, in the 4,000 babies that you've delivered, how many times have you needed the assistance of some of the things that you're talking about here with the high risk?
Part of the tremendous improvement in the outcome of small babies and babies that deliver prematurely are because of neonatal colleagues. And having a very good NICU unit the neonatal intensive care unit is extremely important. And at Mercy, we have a very good NICU unit as well as a good St. Martin Hospital in Suffolk.
So what's it make you feel like when you see a new little baby that's just been born and you've helped deliver it?
By being the next president. I'm waiting for a preemie baby to be the next president.
Well, from your lips to God's ears, I love that idea. Thank you both so much for the work that you do, Kristen Thayer and Dr. Demetrios Mastrogiannis. We really appreciate everything you've been talking about today. And as always, for more information or to schedule an appointment at one of Catholic Health Services' six outstanding hospitals, you can call 1-855-CHS-4500 or visit chsli.org. Thank you so much for joining us today. I'm Jane Hansen, wishing you goodbye and good health.